Okay, so let's start the second part of this lecture. In this part, I will be talking about the shoulder joint. So here, this is an X-ray of the anteroposterior view of the shoulder region, and you can see both joints. Here is the acromioclavicular joint between the clavicle and the acromion of the scapula, which we already talked about. Now, in this segment, I will focus on the glenohumeral joint, which is an articulation between the head of the humerus and the glenoid cavity of the scapula, and it is forming a ball and socket type of synovial joint, where head of the humerus is the ball and the glenoid cavity of the scapula is the socket of the joint. So it is a ball and socket type of synovial joint. So now, if you look at the bones here, so this is the ball and this is the socket of the ball and socket type of synovial joint. And you can see the ball of the joint, the head of the humerus, is much larger than the much smaller glenoid cavity. Okay, so that make this joint a bony, unstable bony complex. Because you see, to be a much more stable joint, the socket would have been much bigger actually, so that the socket should fit the ball much better than what happened in the shoulder joint. Okay, anyway, so this type of configuration make it a relatively unstable bony complex. And also, if you look at the joint capsule of the shoulder joint, and you can see it is in the inferior direction, it's loose actually, so it's a slack joint capsule that also again make it vulnerable to dislocation. And also another thing is the shoulder joint is the most mobile joint in the body. It has a lot of movements in different axes. I will be talking about those movements as well. So anyway, so it's anatomically, it's unstable bony complex. So we'll see the features of this joint. So, you know, all the common features that we talked about, the features of this synovial joint, you will find them in the shoulder joint, where two articulating bones, the head of the humerus and the glenoid cavity, are held together by a joint capsule. And again, joint capsule has two portions. Its outside is fibrous capsule, the inside of the joint, I will be showing you the inside of the joint as well. Inside is lined by the synovial membrane. Okay, and the thickening of the joint capsule form different ligaments. We call them capsular ligaments. Okay, so the capsular ligaments are actually thickening of the fibrous capsule. If we go next, now there are some bursas around the shoulder joint, around the shoulder joint. Here one is, this is the position of the subscapular bursa. Let me talk about the bursa actually. So bursa, I put a note here, you can see. The bursa is a small fluid-filled sac, and that the main function of the bursa, it's more like the water balloon. They lies between two structures to prevent the friction. So the bursa is important, and there are several bursa in shoulder region. I will show the other one as well. But most importantly here, one of the important one is the subscapular bursa. This bursa lies, you see, this is the tendon of subscapular muscle. Subscapularis, it's coming from the, you know, the anterior surface of the scapula and heading towards the lesser tubercle of the humerus. And this position of the subscapular bursa is between the tendon of the subscapularis and the joint capsule to prevent friction. Now, one thing is unique about the subscapular bursa is, so subscapular bursa is formed by, you see, inside this one, the fibrous capsule is the aligning of synovial membrane, right? Now, those synovial membrane protrudes to the opening. There are opening in the fibrous capsule of the shoulder joint. And through this opening, the part of synovial membrane protrudes and form a bursa around here. Now, there are other bursas as well here in this joint. You can see, if I go here, you can see this is another bursa, okay? So this bursa is between the, see, on top of this one will be deltoid muscle. And this one is called, because of its location, either the subdeltoid bursa, or also because it lies underneath the acromion of the scapula, this one is also called the subacromial bursa. Now, the difference between subacromial bursa and the subscapularis bursa is the subscapularis bursa is formed by the synovial membrane, protrusion of the synovial membrane. So that has direct communication of the joint cavity inside of the joint. Okay. Now, there are some other bursas as present in this area as well. So now we talked about the subscapular bursa. This one is subdeltoid or subacromial bursa. And also there is a bursa underneath this, between the skin and the acromial process, which is called the subcutaneous bursa. Okay. So the bursas are the fluid-filled small sacs that prevent the friction between the two structures. Now, we mentioned that the shoulder joint is an unstable bony complex. So to stabilize this unstable bony complex, there are several factors that are in play. Okay. Now, let's talk about them one by one. Now, here are the factors that stabilize the shoulder joint. Number one is glenoid labrum. What is glenoid labrum? So this is the glenoid cavity, right? This is the glenoid cavity and it's lined by articular cartilage because it's a typical feature of a synovial joint, right? Now, glenoid labrum is a fibrocartilaginous ring that lies around the glenoid cavity. Now, what is the importance of glenoid labrum? By forming a fibrocartilaginous ring around the glenoid cavity, that thickened the socket a little bit. Okay, so that even though it's small, but it contributes in the stabilization of the joint. Okay, so how it stabilizes the joint? By thickening the, by deepening the glenoid cavity. Okay, the glenoid cavity of the scapula. Okay, so that is the function of the glenoid labrum. And then rotator cuff. Do you remember we talk about in the muscle section, we talk about a group of four muscles formed by supraspinatus, infraspinatus, teres, so here you can see those muscles actually, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, teres minor, and subscapularis. You see, if you look at the location of this muscle, these muscles are approaching, they arise from the scapula and they approach the shoulder joint and they blend with the fibrous capsule of the shoulder joint, okay? And look at their position. So this supraspinatus is coming from the superior aspect. Infraspinatus is on the posterior aspect. This one is also teres minor is also in the posterior aspect, and the subscapularis is also in the anterior aspect. Okay, that's how they come and approach the joint and form a cuff around the shoulder joint, which is called the rotator cuff. Again, formed by four muscles, and they play a very important role in stabilizing the shoulder joint. And then the coracoacromial arch. You see, this is an arch. This is the acromion of the scapula. This is the coracoid process of the scapula. And this is the coracoacromial ligament. And they form a arch on the top, on the upper, in the upward direction of the shoulder joint. You see, above the shoulder joint. So that also stabilizes the shoulder joint by preventing its dislocation in the upward direction. So they prevent the upward, the dislocation of the shoulder in the upward direction. Now, long head of the biceps. See, when we talk about the proximal end of the humerus, we say there are two large tubercles, greater tubercle and lesser tubercle. In between two tubercle was a depression or sulcus we call intertubercular sulcus because the sulcus lies in between the two tubercles. And the tendon lies in the intertubercular sulcus. And also we said another name of the sulcus is, of the depression is called the bicipital group because this is the tendon of the long head of the biceps. And then see the tendon of the muscle, this is very special actually, it's going right through the shoulder joint. And dividing the joint cavity, the black is the joint cavity, this one is going right through the joint cavity, in the joint cavity and to be inserted in the area called supraglenoid tubercle. So this way, biceps also participate in the contribute, I should say, in the stabilization of the shoulder joint. And another one is the long head of the triceps. Okay, so if I go to this next slide, you see this is the long head of the triceps. Remember, we mentioned even though Triceps is not a muscle of the shoulder region, but we talk about the triceps when we were talking about the boundaries of the quadrangular space and the triangular space. You see this quadrangular space here, and this nerve again is the axillary nerve, and this is the posterior circumflex humeral artery. So see the presence of this long head of the triceps, its insertion into the infraglenoid tubercle also provide some sort of stability of the shoulder joint in the infra direction. This is important because if you look at the stability of the shoulder joint, its rotator cuff is supporting it from the superior aspect, posterior aspect, and anterior aspect. Okay, so no rotator cuff in the inferior aspect. And also we said that if you look at the joint capsule, that is also slack actually in the infra direction. So in the infra direction, the long head of the triceps is important because it provides some stability in the infra direction where there is no rotator cuff. In addition to that, joint capsule is also slack actually in that direction. But the slack joint capsule in infra direction is very important for the movement of the shoulder joint. That allows the complete abduction of the shoulder. Okay. If you have the tight fibrous capsule here, then a complete abduction would not be possible. Okay, so that has a significant, contribution here. Now, when the shoulder joint dislocates, so from these factors, we know that shoulder joint is, have support in the superior direction, posterior direction, anterior direction from the fibrous capsule and also the rotator cuff, right? But it's weak in the infra direction. Only support there is the long head of the triceps. Okay. Now, because of that, the most common dislocation of the shoulder happens in the infra direction. But even though the dislocation happens in the infra direction, after dislocating, the head of the humerus lies either anterior to the infraglenoid tubercle and the long head of the triceps or posterior to those structures. Depending on the position of the head of the humerus, the dislocation is called either anterior dislocation, if the head is located anterior to the infraglenoid tubercle, or it is called posterior direction, if head is located posterior to the infraglenoid tubercle. That is actually, that's how the clinicians classify them. Okay. So that's about the dislocation, and let's talk about the movement of the shoulder joint. We said shoulder joint or glenohumeral joint is a multi-axial joints with wide range of movements. Let's look at the movements one by one. This is a movement extend flexion and extension that take place in the medial to lateral axis. In this axis, the joint that take place is the flexion and extension. Next one is in the anterior posterior axis, which is this one, and the movement that take place in this axis is the adduction and abduction. Okay, and on the vertical axis, the movement that takes place is the medial rotation like this and the lateral rotation like this. And when you combine all these movements, that is called the circumduction. Okay, circumduction is the combination of flexion, extension, abduction, adduction, medial rotation, and lateral rotation. If you have all of them, the circular movement, that is called the circumduction. Okay, again, shoulder joint is the most mobile joint in the body, and it is a ball and socket type of synovial joint. Also, it is a multi-axial joint where the movement take place in different direction, in different axis actually. Again, medial to lateral axis will provide the movement of flexion and extension. In the anterior posterior axis will be the abduction and adduction. On the vertical axis will be medial rotation and lateral rotation. These are the three main axes, and when you combine all these movements, then this is called the circumduction. Okay, so those are the movements of the shoulder joint. So I think that's all that I have for you in this segment. So as I said always, if you have any question or if you have any problem understanding anything, don't hesitate to call me, text me, email me, whichever way is convenient for you. Thank you for your patience and listening. I will see you again on the next lecture. Thank you.